Hello, everyone. Welcome to Artix 8-Bit Bytes, where we talk about AV programming. In this video, we'll tackle a few simple networking tasks that are essential for connecting and communicating with your audio-video equipment. I'd like to point out that I don't really know that much about networking. However, since most AV devices are network-based, it's important for every AV technician to know just a little. Learning just a few tricks and tools can be extremely helpful. So, let's make this easy, fast, and totally doable. We'll start by walking through how to set a static network address on your computer and breaking down the differences between DHCP, DHCP reserved, link local, and static addresses. Then, we'll explore some incredibly helpful tools. Tools like the ping command for locating network devices, the Angry IP scanner utility for scanning your network, and the Bonjour browser for finding those tricky, hard-to-reach devices. Let's talk about the different types of addresses. Then we'll set a static address on your computer. A DHCP address is assigned to your computer by the network that you're connected to. When your computer is set to DHCP, it looks for a network device to provide it with an address. This assigned address typically allows your computer to communicate with other devices on the same network. Usually, when you receive a DHCP address, the network device simply gives you the next available address on its list. Each time you connect, it might give you a different address. In the case of AV devices, you often want to know exactly what the address of the device you want to talk to is. Because a DHCP address can sometimes change, it isn't always the most desirable way to set up an AV network. IT managers can set up what's called a reserve list of MAC addresses for your AV equipment. This way, when your computer and AV equipment are assigned an IP address from the network, they will receive the same IP address every time. This ensures that when you want to talk to an AV device, you can always find it. Using reserved DHCP addressing either requires coordination between the AV technician and IT manager, or a higher level of network programming by the AV technician. So, what happens when your computer is set to receive a DHCP address, but the network you're connected to doesn't give it one? There is this thing called link local. Basically, your computer waits to get an address, and when it doesn't get one, it assigns itself its own address. This address is always in the 169.254.x.x range, with the x's being a number between 1 and 254. Sometimes, AV devices are shipped from the factory with a link local address. So, when your computer doesn't get a DHCP address, it self-assigns what's called a link local address. Your computer can then automatically connect to and find other link local devices, because both your computer and that AV device are using the same IP scheme. More often than not, I prefer to keep my AV networks as simple private networks. I like to statically assign my IP addresses to every device. I then assign a static IP address to my computer so I can then communicate with all those devices on the network. Because everything is statically assigned on this network, I'll make sure that there also isn't anything on the network assigning IP addresses, like a DHCP server. That all has to be shut off. There are several IP schemes that are open and available to use when you are setting up your own network. Typically, you have a 192.168.x.x network. Those are used for more basic home networks. And you have like a 10.0.x.x range, and that's used for more basic business-related networks. There are many more ranges that you can use, but these two are the most widely used. So, if you use a 10.0.0.x network, like said before, the X can be a number between 1 and 254. This allows you to sign up to 255 devices a unique IP address. This will cover almost 99% of the AV networks you'll ever need to create. We will not dive deep into net masks here, but for this simple AV network with 255 addresses, we're going to need the net mask of 255, 255.255.0. And this is typically the most common. This net mask means that the first three numbers, which are also called octets, are used as a network identifier. And the last number, or the last octet in the IP address, is used as a device ID. Now that we've talked about the different types of addresses, let's set a static IP address on your computer. We'll be using Windows 11 for this demonstration. Windows 10 does it slightly differently, but the principles are exactly the same. Setting a static address on other devices like a phone, an iPad, or an Apple machine is also very similar. On the bottom right of your Windows 11 machine, click on the Wi-Fi symbol. In that window, click on the gear icon in the lower right. On the left side, click on Network and Internet. You will see the network device connection icons at the top right. You should have Wi-Fi connections and whatever Ethernet adapters you have on your machine. My Ethernet adapter is called Ethernet 3, or it might be called Ethernet 6. It gives them different names. So, on a side note, it is possible on a Windows machine to have multiple Ethernet adapters. You then can assign different IP settings on each adapter to communicate different networks. Now, click on its Properties tab to set the IP settings on this Ethernet adapter. You should see a heading called IP Assignment. Mine says Automatic, or DHCP, which means it's waiting for an address from another device. Click on Edit. Change the dropdown from automatic to manual. Toggle the IP version 4 settings to on. IP version 4 is what most everyone uses for IP addressing. In the future, we may switch to IP version 6, which allows a lot more IP addresses and a lot more IP addressing options. Under IP address, let's type 10.0.0.250. I personally prefer to statically assign my AV devices in the lower regions of the IP scheme. For example, your network switch might be a 10.0.0.5. We could set a control processor as a .10. Maybe the touchscreen is a .11. Under subnet mask, let's use the normal subnet mask of 255.255.255.0. This will allow you to create a private network for 255 addresses, and using the last number, or octet, of that IP address as your device ID. By setting your AV devices to the lower end of the range, you can then also set your computer as a higher number and not have to worry about grabbing conflicting IP addresses. It's worth noting that I usually leave the first several IP addresses in the network range for network-related devices. Like, I might leave a .1 to .10 open, and maybe the last address, the 10.0.0.255, shouldn't be used either. It's usually used for network broadcast messages on your network. So, under Gateway, Gateway is usually reserved for more advanced networks, where there is a device on the network that's performing routing tasks. In a private network, we are less concerned with this. If a device requires a gateway when you're setting it up, you can always just put in the IP address of your network switch, or you can simply put in the first address of the IP scheme, such as 10.0.0.1. For DNS settings, this is also reserved for more complex networks where there is a domain name server on the network. A domain name server lets you type in the name for a device instead of its IP address. Like google.com is actually a DNS. In basic networks, you won't have a DNS. If a device requires this, you can either type in the IP address of the network switch or the first address in the scheme, like a 10.0.0.1. Or even use the IP address of Google's domain name server, which is 8.8.8.8. Either way, the private network won't have a DNS. You'll just use a device's IP address instead. So now, let's click on Save. At this point, you should see your new device settings listed under Ethernet settings. Now that you know how to switch between DHCP and static IP addresses on your computer, let's discuss how to discover AV devices on your network. To begin, it's important to consult the manual of the device you want to connect to. Some AV devices come from the factory with a static IP address. For such devices, you'll need to set a static address on your computer that matches the same IP scheme, but with a different address. Common examples include certain network switches, most PTZ cameras, and devices like a global cache relay box. These come pre-configured with a static IP address. It's worth noting here that, let's say you have three cameras. They probably will be shipped all with the same static IP address. So what you don't want to do is don't plug in all three cameras to your network until you have discovered and reset the IP address individually for each camera. It is always a common practice to connect a device one at a time, set its IP, verify the IP has been set correctly, then move on to the next device. On the other hand, many devices like most Crestron and QSC QSIS products come with DHCP enabled by default. In many cases, Link Local will also work for these devices. They won't get an IP address, they'll self-assign a Link Local address, and then they can communicate also. If you happen to know a device's IP address, and your computer is on that same network, like how we set the IP scheme earlier, a great way to verify that everything is talking is by using the ping network command. So here's how to do that. Open the search tool in Windows 11 and type terminal. Launch a terminal window. To check if your computer can communicate with that other device, say a Crestron processor with the IP address of 10.0.0.10, let's type in ping 10.0.0.10 and then hit enter. If that device is on the same network, you'll receive a ping response, indicating successful communication. The ping command is also useful if you want to check to see if an IP address is being used on a network before programming a new device with that same IP address. When you have two devices on a network with the same IP address, you get what's called an IP conflict. What will happen is that each device will fight back and forth for that same IP. Usually, power cycling that device will cause it to re-grab that IP address back again. Another sign of an IP conflict is if a device constantly goes on and offline, let's say with a control processor or you keep losing a touchscreen. A great way to check for this is you disconnect one of the devices from the network. Then you ping that IP address. If something else pings back with that device connected, then you know you just found your problem. There's two devices on the same network. While we're still in the terminal window, I want to show you another command. It's called ipconfig. So let's type ipconfig and then enter. This command will tell you all the network connections on your computer and their IP settings. This is a great way to confirm that your computer is using the IP address that we assigned statically earlier. Once your computer is set to the proper IP range, Angry IP Scanner allows you to scan all the IP addresses within that range to identify any live devices. You can download Angry IP Scanner from their official website. When you open Angry IP Scanner, you'll see the range of IP addresses it will scan in the top left. Sometimes, if your Wi-Fi connection is also on, Angry IP Scanner might use that IP range instead of the statically set IP range that we set earlier. It's usually helpful to turn off your Wi-Fi connection on your computer first. However, you can simply type in the IP range that you'd like to scan, and it will scan the Ethernet port with that same IP range. So, for example, let's type 10.0.0.1 to 10.0.0.255 for the range. and let's hit start. Any active Ethernet devices in that range will be indicated with a green connected icon. Additionally, the scanner will show which ports the device wants to communicate with. If it indicates port 80, there might be a web page at that IP address where you can change that device's settings. In this case, you would simply go to Internet Explorer or some web browser and type in the IP address, and its web page will pop up. If you don't know or can't find the IP address of a device, first check if the device's manufacturer provides a utility for discovering the device on a network. Another useful tool for finding a lost device is called Bonjour Browser. Bonjour Browser detects devices that create network broadcast messages. It can identify devices using a different network IP address than what you have set on your computer. To avoid scanning your Wi-Fi connection immediately, turn off your Wi-Fi. Ensure your Ethernet cable is connected to a network that you want to scan. Then open the utility. Bonjour Browser will list any devices it detects on the network. Clicking on a device in the top window will usually show its current IP address in the bottom. And now you've found that device. So, that concludes this video on AV networking basics. Also, thanks for watching Artix 8-Bit Bytes. I'm thrilled to be one of your internet AV programming resources. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit the like button, share it with your friends, and subscribe for more AV programming content.